Apparently, the Pyramid of the Sun in Mexico looked like this before 1910. And news story out now, I'll just go through these images quickly, is this Mr. Menchaca just did a study based on some very high-tech subatomic particles, and apparently it took him about many years to get approval and then 10 years to build the machine to do this. And they determined the fact that, here he is right here, the nuclear physicist. In fact, the Pyramid of the Sun is in danger of collapsing, according to him, because of Portland cement concrete. Yeah, I'm staying on topic here. This wasn't just a really random thing. So, yeah, so anyway, in about 1910, so they did soundings. It's like a, they can go much deeper with this type of detection device that's really cutting-edge technology, and they determined that on the sunny side, the most of this presentation will be all images. On the sunny side, here's the restoration from 1910 that was done then. And so what they did is they dug away a bunch of dirt and put in a whole bunch of concrete. And so on the sunny side, what has happened that it's dried out because there's no vapor transmission. And so the end result is the recommendation to create vapor transmission is to dig it back up again and remove the concrete. And you know, it's a dirt pyramid. It's packed. It's earthen. And so the point being that Portland cement-based concretes were the next best thing since sliced bread. And so here we go. So they were invented in Portland cement was invented about 1824, but it didn't really come into widespread use. This is from Preservation Briefs 2, for anyone who doesn't know, great resource for knowledge. It's on the internet. But this Preservation Brief 2 is about historic pointing, which is directly related to, you know, cements. And just there's not going to be many images like this, but this is what Portland cement can do to historic brick. And I'm preaching to the choir here, as Joe mentioned before, to the large degree, but we have people of different knowledge bases here. So anyway, here we go. What was that? Wrong button. Okay, so what we run into a lot in graveyards is the most common thing is tablet stones that are snapped and repaired by puddling them into concrete, and it makes it very hard to rework them. So I'm just going to go through some images of things and then some solutions as well. So you can see concrete on one side. This is in Trinity Churchyard in New York City in Manhattan. That is concrete, three stones. You know, they formed it, and it's above ground, but it's still, you know, three stones put into one mass of concrete. This is in Hampton, New Hampshire, and, you know, they get carried away. I mean, if you can do a couple, why not do a whole cemetery? This is in South Salem, New York. There's a couple good close-ups here. This is something that I worked on. And so what you'll find often sometimes is they actually cap the existing bases. I have some ladder pictures of that as well. But you can see here the, let me see if I can work this, okay, there we go. So you can see what happens when you, you know, embed this more, you know, marble around the concrete is that it is, well, it's pretty really crumbling, just disintegrating, like granular disintegration, sugaring. And, you know, that's what will tend to happen if you combine these unlike materials. So here's a kind of sequence of shots. So this is in Enfield, Connecticut. And so this is exactly how I found this. You know, just like these two shots indicate, just a typical broken 2-inch tablet slab stock. You'll see that all over America. Little bit of excavation. Better to get under the foundation if you can, but when you're way underground, that can be very problematic. So then I was able to lift this mass of concrete along with the lower portion of the tablet, and here it is repaired but not cleaned. The snow came before I had a chance to do that. So then neat cement is a cement mortar or grout or glue that's made without the addition of sand or lime, so just straight up Portland cement. So if you want something really strong, impossible to ever get off a material and rework, and completely incompatible with any softer material, it's a great choice. So here we have a stone that's out on Cape Cod in a town, Eastham. And this was on like a brownstone, maybe a Connecticut brownstone, I'm not sure. But they used it as a glue and an infill material. And needless to say, it failed. So in that situation, oftentimes you just have to leave it. Unless you want to try to grind it off, because chiseling it off assuredly will take a lot of stone with it, and it may just destroy it. And as they will say in medicine, you could destroy the cancer and kill the patient. So you gotta use your judgment a lot. So here we have, this is kind of goes back to some of Irving's images from Massachusetts. We have when they would form something like this. And I mean, I sometimes they would do this in a stone, and inset it into a granite, and really that's a high-end repair. But this is more common when they would just puddle it, right in on the flat so they can stand it up. I mean, at least they saved the stone, and oftentimes the pieces will disappear if they didn't do something. So these things are historic. This was in Woonsocket, Mass, and these people in the front row here were at this site with me. This is a great one here. So this is at the same site. And so this is exactly how this object was found. And so it's hard to tell what's really going on here. There's definitely a previous repair. We can see the base. This is the lower base. It's, I believe, a granite base. It's a marble headstone. First thing to do is excavate. It was embedded in concrete on the flat. Fortunately, what we hope for is that they were as slapdash about their concrete work, and so they made weak concrete because they didn't use a lot of Portland cement and or didn't do any prep, so there was a lot of dirt on the stone, and then it might not adhere well. The thing about this was that I was missing a middle base here. The lower base was good. I raised it up and leveled it, but there was an upper base, or some people will call it a mid base, or occasionally a plinth block. The names are kind of blurred. Here was the entrance to the cemetery, and I kept walking in and out, and then it occurred to me the step here that I kept walking over looked suspiciously a lot like the missing base. And in fact, I measured it, and it was the missing base. And either that or a dead ringer. Interesting to note here that the carver's name is on here, but it's upside down. I spent a little bit of time trying to get this out, and it was absolutely fully embedded. And on the back end, it was just puddled all the way, actually coming over the top. And, the way to get something like this apart, if you really had to, would be to just drill a whole bunch of holes around it, probably, and get under it. And, you could spend, a half a day, and you might still damage it badly. So it was decided to, there it is. There's a close-up of the carver for anyone who knows carver. People don't study the carvers that much in the Victorian era as they did in the colonial era, but nonetheless, more like a monument company. So then what I did is I casted a replacement out of Portland cement, but I didn't puddle it into it. I created a socket and then set it into it with a historic pointing mortar. And then after the loss was filled, also that it had to be broken apart, and then that Portland cement up here had to be chiseled away. This is a stone I encountered. I didn't work on this one, but this is one I encountered in Deadwood, South Dakota. And so it was a really hilly cemetery there. And so I really liked their solution. They obviously didn't have a bar, they didn't attend my seminar on leverage. So they decided that they would just add some Portland cement, but they were nice enough to date it so that at least we know the age of this workmanship. We have the pretty cool pattern on the lower base, and then it's probably like, well, in a lot, all over the country, in a lot of areas, they'll use a different material for the lower base as they will for the mid base. This would be like a gray marble, and the lower base here, I don't recall, it looks like a white marble, but I'm not really sure what it was. This is, I tried to kind of represent the country here because we're missing a lot of attendance from places, so I'll kind of at least show their images. So this is in Coos Bay, Oregon. And I was told in Oregon, you got to think of an or and a gun. You don't say Oregon, or they know you're not from Oregon, and they might get out their gun. So you say or and a gun, or and a gun. So anyway, a little bit of Portland cement here. And you'll see this in a lot of areas out west when they make like trellising and they do all kinds of landscape work with Portland cement. It's not just limited to stone repair. So this stone was important to this. I did a workshop out there about 5 years ago, but this family hired me to work on to fix this one monument. It's their family monument. And so what I found out is that, well, this is this giant mass. It's like a whole, you know, well, you can see it's a giant piece of concrete. And so what I decided to do is shim this up and then build this up with like a historic pointing mortar so that this upper base here would be, you know, level in all dimensions so that I could then set the upper component onto it. So the lower base obviously was unchanged because it's fully embedded into concrete. So here it is after, and then I think I did infill work, but I didn't have that image handy. So here's another one. This is back, I just showed some earlier shots. This is Ring Swamp Cemetery in Hampton, New Hampshire. And so they did something pretty cool here. They decided that even if the stones were in good condition, that they would cover all the bases and stuff with concrete anyway, just for fun. And so luckily, it was, like I said, poor quality concrete, and also it had a lot of rock in it. And so I found that after experimenting that I could actually just break it away without damaging the stone if I was careful. You can see there was like a little chippage here, but pretty much it broke away. But the interesting thing is that there was no reason for it in the first place. It had a full base on it, and it wasn't even broken. And so it's like, you know, what are they thinking? It's hard to know. So here's another one. Yeah, same cemetery. So you can see the kind of concrete collar technique and, you know, big chunks of, you know, it's like a batch mix, you know, and then big chunks of rock, you know, gravel mixed in. So that's why it was able to be broken away as well as it was. I found that it was actually much safer in the case of stones like this. What I could do is just like cartwheel them out of the hole first, and then to get this off, a lot of times it's better to hit it up into the mass of it because it's much less likely you'll break off the bottom because there's more surface area up here and it's much stronger that way. So that's what I did. So there's some of my my workmanship. They were nice. The town was nice enough to take that away from me. So there's the same stone after, with, you know, after it was leveled and there was never anything wrong with it in the first place before the concrete. This is in Richmond, Kentucky. This is the monument for Cassius Clay. Cassius Clay was actually a guy who was in Abraham Lincoln's administration. And Cassius Clay, the boxer's father, was named after this guy. I worked on this monument. And I threw this in. This is a Kentucky limestone base, really bad erosion. I actually restored this whole base. But you can see the way they capped it with a hard Portland cement, which only created more problems and, you know, trapped moisture. I just threw this one image of that in. So I rolled through these pretty quick. Now I have a kind of a series here on this one job, and so I showed the entrance of this nice little cemetery. And so I got hired to go fix this one stone. And so I travel all over, obviously, and so this wasn't that far, but still when you're going you know, a couple hours or whatever, you don't want to have to go back if it's a small job because it's, you know, it's a one-day job. If I go back, then, you know, it's a two-day job. So, you know, that's not a good thing, you know. So so I get there and, you know, I see this. Well, of course, it's in Portland cement. What else is new? You know, everything's in Portland cement. So I'm like, okay, that's all right. Like, I have a lot of ability to, like, move things. So my first thing is, like, what I'm going to do, I see this. I'm like, I'm going to, like, pry this thing out of the ground with this concrete is connected to. I'm going to make a new, cast a new base, you know, just underground with a socket, and then I'm going to reset this thing. Well, then I start digging, and what I find is, it's like, it goes, you know, straight to the center of the earth. That this thing, I'm not joking, I had an 8-foot bar with me, and I couldn't move it at all. I mean, it didn't move. There was no movement. And so, I mean, you could move, you know, a few thousand pounds with this bar, and it wasn't moving. So I don't know. I never saw the bottom of it. So I decided that I wasn't going to move it. So I broke away that top piece of the tablet. So just to back up a little, you can't join something to this. There's too much loss. It's really sugary. You know, it's all broken down. And so you can see what happened actually when you smack it with a hammer, that you get this, it breaks up and it just turns into, you know, powder, a lot of it, because it has no strength. And so then what I did is I made a form. I thought I had a picture of it in, somehow I missed one. Yeah, that's okay. So I built a form. And I had enough stuff with me to do this. I always have all cordless tools and everything, but I was short, so that's why there's a scab here holding two pieces together. I had just enough material with me to get this thing built. And so what you see in the center here is foam, you know, high density, rigid foam, like styrofoam insulation, and 2-inch thick. And so I put this obviously right on top, but then in order to do this, I also had to make sure, because this is a finished thing now, you know, it's got to be right in line with the row. There is an existing row there. And then also it has to be leveled in both directions, pretty close. I mean, I have some room to, you know, leeway because of the socket and when you set it, but it's got to be really close or it's not going to look good when it's done. So then it was broken at an angle, and depending, I mean, if it's just a little bit, you can just, you know, shim it up a little, but it's better to square it off. So, again, I use cordless tools a lot, and so I scored it, and then I cut it with a diamond blade on a grinder. So it's, you know, this is showing the whole process. So there's the fresh cut that's nice and square. So here, then I tore the foam out. Remember, this is all one day, so you got to use fast set concrete. And so you can see it's a little rough on the edges because I tore it out so fast. I tore it out in about an hour. And also, usually I'll break down the form first. It's all screwed together, so it all comes apart. But because the concrete was so green, even with fast set, I left the boards in longer, so I pulled the center first. And so then I put historic pointing mortar in. Then I set the stone and then used the stakes as temporary support. And so there it is, all set. And you can see the light is pretty low, so I basically used most of the day. I always have a couple of rechargeable battery-powered flashlights with me, and so more than once it's been even darker than this. That's it. I went through them quick, so.